here and can wander over there, though I probably will stay pretty much here. Is it going? Okay, great. So hello everyone and welcome to 15780. I hope everyone is here for that course. I know there was some confusion about the room it was in because we were in a different room first. I think there was some leaking of information from the older version where we were in a different room to this syllabus. So this is the room. We're going to stay here. And it actually looks pretty good. I was worried it would be too full, but maybe sort of there was already some trimming down a little bit. So anyway, this is the graduate AI course, and I'm going to talk today about the range of topics we're going to cover in this course, and as well of, though I actually did that very briefly, what I'm mainly going to cover today is some history of AI, as well as talk about the course logistics, right? Talk about just, you know, how many problem sets are there, how do you turn in homework, this kind of stuff. So before I begin, though, I want to start by asking the question of what AI is, right? Because I think that a lot of you taking this course, you hear the word AI, and you might not really know what AI is. You know it sort of encompasses a lot of things, but there's sort of this question of, well, what is artificial intelligence? We all have some notion of it, I think, but I don't know if everyone, there is a really good definition. So the way that the textbook describes it, and I think this is a good way of thinking about this. This has sort of been a classical way of thinking about what AI is it is the study of some of the combination of these things, right? It's how do we make programs that think like humans or think rationally or act like humans or act rationally. And I'm just going to sort of jump right in and talk about some of these ideas, where they come from and why they might be useful. Even though in this course we're not going to really delve into many of these ideas too much, we're really going to present you with a lot of topics on AI as a whole. So for starters, let's talk about thinking like humans. For a long time, AI was thought of as, well, how do we build something? We know the brains are smart. How do we build something like a brain that is also going to be smart? And this is a great idea, right? We know we have an existence proof of one thing that's smart, our brains. Let's try to build that. The problem here, though, is that this requires, to a certain extent, that we have some idea of how the brain works. And the reality is we don't really, right? So we might be sort of getting ahead of ourselves. We start trying to build artificial brains. Maybe we can't really do that yet. At least we don't really know how they work. And so this kind of idea has been more the purview of things like cognitive science rather than AI, at least in recent years. And there's the other point. This is the point of Alan Turing, who is going to come up actually several times in this lecture. The other point is that maybe machines could do something internally that's actually quite different from what humans are doing. Right? We don't need the same neural pathways. Maybe we could still reach intelligence that way. Right, so for that reason, I think this idea, thinking like humans, it's a fantastic, I mean, how we think is a hugely important problem, but it's not one that typically is the focus of artificial intelligence, at least in the current view. So because of this, a lot of initial AI researchers kind of shifted from this view of thinking like humans to thinking rationally. Right, that seems like a kind of a better goal in some sense. Why don't we just try to think rationally, whatever that may mean. And you can define it formally, but I'll just talk about it informally for now. And this led, at least initially, to a big beginning of things like automated reasoning and logic as a foundation of AI. And this was a big theme, big original theme in AI research, but at the same time, a few problems arose too. So a few problems that arose were searching through logical derivations is a very hard computationally intensive task. And it's also unclear if logic really is a good way of representing all the kinds of kind of fuzzy knowledge that, I shouldn't use that term fuzzy because that means something very different, it means something very, very specific, I should say, but all the kinds of human knowledge people actually have. It's unclear if logic really captures all that. So next people started talking about, well, why don't we just forget about thinking how we think, because sort of thinking itself isn't really the goal here. The goal is acting in some sense. We want to interact with the world. And so because of this, there was a shift to, and I shouldn't really say a shift because this isn't like it's a temporal sequence here, but there's another view that says, why don't we instead think or try to act like humans? And the famous example here is the Turing test. Right? The Turing test, for those who don't know, is you talk to a computer, and it's a simplified version, but you talk to a computer or a human via a terminal, and you try to tell which one is which. Right? Seems like a simple idea. We'll talk about it more in a second. But again, this has some issues. Right? And so, for example, if you as a interviewer were to ask a computer, what are these two big numbers multiplied by each other? The computer should rightfully say, well, I don't know. Right? It should say, I'm just a human. I can't do that. Possibly. I couldn't do that very quickly at all. And so, in some sense, the idea of acting like humans is a little bit arrogant, right? Because we think that the humans are somehow the pinnacle of intelligence when there are already things that computers do much better than us. And so, because of this, maybe the last box here is the one that's most often adopted. And it's adopted by the textbook, for example, that you'll see, which is the concept of acting rationally instead. And this is the basis for what's called the intelligent agent, which is the framework that's talked about in the Russell and Norvig textbook. But again, I'm not sure if this idea of acting rationally really captures the variety of topics that are covered by AI today. When you talk about AI, I don't think myself or many other AI researchers really think about acting rationally or building rationally acting agents as the foundation of all their work. And so the question comes up, well, how else can we define it? If we're not really thinking about it like this, how else can we define it? I think I actually maybe jumped into this a little too quickly here. I should say I'm going to cover logistics of it at the end of this lecture, and there'll be plenty of time for that, plenty of time to ask questions. The first bit here is going to be kind of just jumping right into what is AI and the history of AI. So if it seems a bit rushed, don't worry. We're jumping right into the topic itself because that's the most interesting part, right? The course content, all that kind of stuff, midterm, homeworks, you'll find about that later in the lecture. But it will be today in this lecture, so don't worry if you're on edge, think you missed something. I'd also say, please do interrupt if you have questions at any point. This lecture at least is supposed to be a discussion, and you're welcome to ask. But we will force interaction later on through this Piazza platform that we'll demo in a second. Okay, so jumping back into the little story I'm telling now. If AI is not about rational agents, then what is it? It's a sort of this very amorphous concept, right? And another sort of tautological explanation, which is a kind of a pragmatic viewpoint, right, is that just AI covers everything that, well, people call AI. And essentially, it's not a bad definition, right? Because AI has meant and has referenced a lot of different things over time. And we can actually look at what AI has been over time. We can look at the conferences in AI. And these next graphics are going to be word clouds of the main AI, or a main AI conference. This is called AAAI, American Association for Advanced. Yeah, right, because it's no longer American. Anyway, I forget what it stands for because they've changed it a couple times. It's a very large conference in AI, AAAI. And I took all the titles of the papers in these conferences and built a word cloud out of them. Okay, so this is what AI was in the 80s. And reasoning is the big thing, and knowledge and systems. You probably have experts here somewhere, right? You have other things like using too, but that's going to be in every title. But this is sort of what AI was. And it would be this actually similar things, but again, a little different, going backwards as well. There was this strong kind of emphasis on reasoning and understanding and building systems and knowledge, sort of historically in AI. And we'll go through some of the history in a second. Now what you see is in the 90s, this shift away from knowledge. Knowledge is still there, but it's getting smaller. Things like search and systems and planning are certainly dominant still, but of course learning is the one that stands out here. And this is somewhat indicative of kind of what AI as a field has focused on. So in the 90s really when it happened and started in the 80s, but in the 90s really when machine learning kind of broke out as a subfield of AI, and this really kind of got a lot of interest in systems that learn, that improve themselves over time. And this trend continues. So the reasoning and knowledge are getting smaller, learning's getting bigger. And other things are coming up. It's actually kind of interesting to study these things. You have things coming up like games and agents here, and stochastic optimizations coming about for the first time. We'll talk a lot about optimization in this course. But then now the 2010s, learning kind of dominates this word graph, at least. And I don't think this is necessarily indicative of all that AI is. It's just that learning is an easy word to put in titles, too. We forgot to remember that as well, right? So learning how to do X is sort of obvious as a title, whereas if you're doing a paper on vision, you don't necessarily say vision in your title. You just say what task you're trying to focus on. So, you know, there's some bias here, certainly, but I think it's also kind of instructive. The problem, though, is that this doesn't really tell us sort of more fundamentally what AI is, right? It just says what people have thought of as AI. And so it's just descriptive, right? It doesn't really tell us what will it be, what really is it. And we're not going to answer that question in this course, I should say. I really don't care much about that. But if you want a definition, I think the following suffices. It's very, very vague. It's nowhere. I just came up with this, you know, in the past couple of days. It's nothing that concrete here. So don't take too much out of this. But I would just say that AI really is the study, the development and study of computer algorithms that somehow address problems we have typically associated with intelligence. All right, and that's very kind of vague, but I think it's actually pretty reasonable, right? Because things like computer vision. We see vision as being some sign of intelligence, right? If we can recognize shapes or understand a scene, we see that as being some kind of intelligence. And so that's part of AI. Similarly, learning, right? Learning systems that improve over time, we typically see these as being some manifestation of intelligence. And so learning is also, machine learning is also part of AI. But again, this is a very kind of vague definition here, and it's intentionally that way. What AI really is, in some sense, is a dispersed collection of topics that fall under this umbrella for some reason. And we'll, in a second, as you probably saw from the syllabus, but we'll also put it up there in a few more slides down, you probably also saw some or have some notion of different topics that are covered by this framework of AI. So now let me switch gears a little bit and go from sort of what AI is, kind of in some metaphysical way, to what has AI done? What is the history of AI? What have we done and accomplished in AI over the past 60 years? So I'm not going to give a history of AI, really, though. It would be impossible to do that without leaving out very important topics, and so I don't want to take this as an exhaustive collection, or anything close to an exhaustive collection of milestones in AI. It's just some things that I happen to know about that I think are cool, that have happened historically, with a little bit more focus on older things, by the way, too. I'll mention newer things, but it's good to know. We're going to cover the newer stuff all throughout this course, so it's interesting to know kind of when these things originate, and what really came about when in the history of AI. This is not going to be the topic of the course. We won't talk about history much. We'll talk about the algorithms and the actual methods themselves. But it is good to know kind of where these things evolved and where they came from. So while I think people, every textbook will sort of have a different description of when AI started, right? I think the Norvig book says like Aristotle, Russell Norvig says Aristotle was the first AI researcher. Because he was talking about logic and how what intelligence is and all these things that are very, very important. But for our purposes, we'll talk about AI really starting in some sense, or at least coming into its own, with Alan Turing and this famous Turing test. Because this was one of the first times, not the first time, but one of the first times, or at least one of the first famous times, where the idea of computers being actual intelligent beings really came about. Okay? So in 1950, Alan Turing published a paper called Computing Machinery and Intelligence. I think it was published in Mind magazine, right? So this is like a philosophical journal. It was published, not a computing journal. And you probably, who here is familiar with Turing tests? Show of hands. Oh, wow, not as many as I thought. Okay, so this is good to sort of let you know. So Turing test is very simple. I mentioned it before, but the idea is this. You, as an interviewer, are in a room cloistered off with a little computer screen and a little computer terminal. And you're talking to two different people. And you have essentially two windows in your thing. You're talking to person one or maybe person two. And you can ask both of them questions. And at the end of the test, you have to say which one of these two people is a computer and which is a human that you're talking to. The idea is it's all done over a computer, so you're just typing questions and they're typing responses. But through that interaction, you're supposed to figure out whether someone is a person or someone is a computer. This is really a brilliant idea when he first came up with it, right? Because it took this thing, which is intelligence, which is this thing that's been debated for 2,000 years, at least before that, which is a very amorphous concept. And it took this amorphous concept and turned it into an experimental result, something you could test. Okay, so now intelligence was not about some artificial construct in your, or, you know, I forget what Aristotle calls intelligence, but there's some very complex, and philosophers after that have also been very complex in what it is. But the Turing test gives us a concrete answer. Is this machine intelligent or not? Can it pass this more than X number of times? Assuming, you know, the person is somewhat intelligent, the person's trying to figure this out, the person knows the limits of computation, etc. Now, I don't think, and actually, talking with some of the people now who are, you know, there aren't too many of them left, but talking with some of the people who started AI, I don't get the impression that the Turing test really motivated them to pursue these things. They were interested in constructing these systems for their own sake, right? These are important systems that should be built. But the Turing test provides this wonderful kind of test for empirically verifying whether something is truly intelligent. And by the way, we're nowhere close to passing this yet. Despite you might hear sort of, they hold them every year and, you know, they can fool people that are trying to be fooled essentially, but we're nowhere close to this yet, as you might imagine, right? The other thing, which I mentioned before being a problem of the Turing test, is that it does sort of fall into this trap of, well, why are humans kind of the be-all, end-all of intelligence? Why do we want to do that? Couldn't we do something better? And I think that's certainly valid, but at the same time, you might say, well, okay, that's true. There's certainly intelligence better than humans, but if it can imitate humans flawlessly, that's pretty good. That's sort of, we're satisfied with that, at least to a certain extent. So that was 1950, this first came about. And then what's amazing is how many things happened into the next 10 years from this. How much of the groundwork for a lot of what we're going to talk about in this class was laid within the next 10 years, when computers, remember, were incredibly hard to use. Not many people could actually use computers. There were enormous things that sort of, A, you had to get time on one, and B, they just weren't that easy to program. So in the 1950s, Arthur Samuel developed what some people call the first AI program. Actually, people call different things the first AI program. The next one is also called the first AI program that I'll have a slide on. But Arthur Samuel wrote a checkers playing program. And this program played checkers and it achieved good skill at checkers. Not excellent, but as good as sort of a advanced amateur. And the cool thing was that Arthur Samuel himself did not really know how to play checkers that well, or so the saying goes. What he did instead was developed a version of game search, in particular something based on what's called alpha beta pruning, which is something we'll learn about, I think, in the search lectures. He developed that. It also includes position scoring, which is a pretty advanced concept, actually, you know, talking about the value of being in a certain state. And it had actually a learning component, too. It actually learned a lot by playing itself. And this was in the 50s. So this is really impressive that this all happened. It wasn't maybe as well known as it should have been at the time, because he kind of kept it a little bit more quiet at IBM. Didn't sort of quite get his name out there as much as other people have. But this was really an amazing accomplishment at the time. One of the next things that happened, and it happened, I would say here, I can't say that though, because it actually happened when Newell and Simon were at the RAND Corporation in Santa Monica, California. But we can claim Newell and Simon, right? The building over there is named after them. They were both at CMU for a long time. So this is a CMU advance here. Newell and Simon developed what's also called the first AI program in 55-56, called the Logic Theorist. And this program tried to prove mathematical theorems from Principia Mathematica. So this is sort of the basic rules of logic, how they build up rules of math, essentially. And this was really a pioneering effort for intelligent systems. It kind of, for the first time, talked about logic and search and trying to formulate in a computer program, proving a theorem, proving a logical theorem in terms of search in a tree. And I think a famous quote, I forget if it was, I think, see, Herb Simon said this. He said that when he came back after doing this, he said that over Christmas, Al Newell and I had developed a thinking machine or something like this. Like, it was a few weeks of work for them, the core part of it at least. It actually even found a shorter proof for one well-known theorem. So not only did it was able to prove existing theorems that we knew about, it actually found what's considered a more elegant proof of one theorem from this book that was very complex. So this is a time of immense optimism and kind of we're breaking new ground here that we've never ever touched before. This all culminated in some extent at this Dartmouth conference. And I'm not gonna say anything about this other than this is sort of a famous event in the history of AI, so you should at least have heard of it. This Dartmouth conference was organized by John McCarthy, Marvin Minsky, who were both the sort of maybe the two main pioneers of AI. I guess along with Newell and Simon, so I shouldn't say anyone's a main pioneer of AI. And some more senior people here, including information theory guy. But this conference, it's credited at least with inventing the term artificial intelligence. So this was sort of the first time this term became used to encapsulate all of that. Newell and Simon debuted their logic theorist here. And overall, these people spent a lot of time, I think like about a month in this, you know, just talking and brainstorming ideas. And a field was more or less born out of this. So this is credited, even though there obviously is work that predates it, this is credited as being kind of the originator of artificial intelligence as a field. And finally, the last thing I'm going to talk about in the 50s at least is that Frank Rosenblatt at IBM, I believe, also, developed a perceptron, what he called the perceptron machine. Okay, the perceptron machine was a hardware machine at the time, it wasn't done in software, but essentially it was implementing an algorithm that would take images, in this case images of characters, and use this algorithm, which is really a machine learning algorithm that is not that different from what people use today. Frankly, it's very, very similar. To learn to classify English letters from their images. All right, so this is now within the first 10 years of computers really being available, period. And they were available in the 40s a little bit, but the first time of computers being available, within 10 years of sort of this Turing test being proposed, there had been progress on game playing, logic and automated reasoning, AI as a field, and then also machine learning. With incredibly rudimentary hardware that's nothing like what we have today, this was all developed within the first 10 years. Now, AI, in the course of history, AI has you know, certain trends of AI have waxed and waned. There's been more interest in logic at first, and then more interest in machine learning now. But these are not new ideas fundamentally. These all came about during this time here. And it was sort of this amazing time for laying the framework of what we all still are doing now. So now I'm going to talk about a couple other notable things that happened in, including some videos, a couple notable things that happened in AI. But I'm really not going to, this is not even close to an exhaustive list. These are a couple of things that I kind of find myself fun, and they're fun to show. But after this, these next things, you can pick and choose whichever ones you want, whichever ones sort of are most interesting to you. So, in 1966, Joseph Weizenbaum developed ELIZA. Who here has heard of ELIZA, by the way? Not that many. Okay, great. So I'll get to show you all a script from ELIZA. What ELIZA was ELIZA was called a chatterbot now. They didn't have that term then. But essentially, it's a computer that will talk to you. So you talk with a computer, much like a Turing test. But as you'll see, it can't quite pass a Turing test then or now. And ELIZA was developed as kind of a virtual therapist program, which is very useful because therapists are very easy to code because they never actually answer anything, right? They just ask you questions back when you ask a question. So this was a program, and actually, He wrote this program almost kind of as a sign of what couldn't be intelligent. Of course this isn't intelligent, but yet it was taken seriously by a lot of people. And so this very rudimentary kind of pattern matching and simple language processing actually inspired a lot of future work. So I'm going to show you a couple transcripts from ELISA, including the one that first was published along with the ELISA paper in the communications of the ACM. So this is a conversation of a young woman with ELISA. ELISA's responses here are in capital letters, and her questions are, or comments are in lowercase. So she comes and comes to the terminal and says, "Men are all alike." And ELISA says, "In what way?" "They're always bugging us about something or other. Can you think of a specific example?" "Well, my boyfriend made me come here." "Your boyfriend made you come here?" I don't know if that was a question or a comment. And she says, "I'm depressed much of the time." "I am sorry to hear you are depressed. It's true, I am unhappy." "Do you think coming here will help you not to be unhappy?" "I need some help, that much seems certain." "What would it mean to you if you got some help?" "Perhaps I could learn to get along with my mother. Tell me more about your family." And this is pretty good, right? I mean, this is actually, I could imagine this actually happening. It would be a little bit odd, right? But if you suspend your disbelief and just think of it as a conversation, this is totally plausible. What you will find if you interact with ELISA, and you can, by the way, there's lots of links to current ELISA programs that more or less follow the original program here, is that it quickly gets very frustrating unless you really are willing to either get lucky and talk about your family, which has ELISA a lot of keywords for family and mothers and fathers and stuff like that. You'll quickly kind of hit some barriers that are kind of frustrating. So here was my conversation with ELISA, which I started. I said, "Hello," and it says, "How do you do? Please state your problem." "I am worried that I'm just speaking to a computer. Do computers worry you?" "No, but I'm trying to discern if you are a real person or a computer." "Are you just saying no to be negative? Are you saying no just to be negative? You did not address my question." "Your question," I think this is the question here, so it says, "Your question, question mark. Are you a computer?" And then it goes back to, "Do computers worry you?" and it will go on this forever, of course. It will keep going. So the illusion breaks down pretty fast, right? At the same time, this was sort of this great breakthrough. I wouldn't call it a breakthrough again, because it was known to be kind of a bunch of clever hacks together. But it was this interesting thing that you could actually program a computer with some pretty rudimentary knowledge, and this would create something like a conversation. And I think these examples generated a lot of initial optimism about, and I'll have a quote at the very end about, you know, how soon people thought they were going to be able to develop general purpose AI systems. It was very soon. And I think this kind of stuff really, really kind of cemented that, right? Because these things look plausible, and they look like, wow, we're really getting there. Taking a different tack now, that was, ELISA was sort of a purely program you'd interact with through a terminal. There was also concurrently a lot of progress in robotics at this time. So one of the first general purpose robots was this robot called Shaky, developed at Stanford Research Institute. And the goal of this was to develop a general purpose robot that's capable of interacting and reasoning with the world. I'm going to play a video now about Shaky the robot. It's about 5 minutes long, so it's a little bit long, but really it covers so many things that I think it's just this great, again, this is 1966, it's this great encapsulation of what a lot of AI is still about. And they were already thinking about these things 50 years ago. So let's start playing this thing. Oh, I don't have, sorry. Let me back up, see if this works. Okay, well, we'll see if this plays. No. All right.
Even though the tasks we give Shaky seem quite simple, the programs needed to plan and coordinate his activities are complex. The main purpose of our research is to learn how to design these programs so that robots can be employed in a variety of tasks, ranging from space exploration to industrial automation. Shaky operates in this experimental environment of room, doorways, and simple objects. In our first task for Shaky, we want him to use this box to block this door, starting from this position. The robot executive is capable of understanding a wide variety of English statements, questions, and commands. We can type Shaky's first task in English, which is translated into predicate calculus, the language used by Strips. Strips analyzes the task and produces a plan to solve it. Let's diagram the plan found by Strips. First, Shaky plans to use the action go to D5 that will take him to the doorway. Then he will use the actions go through D5 and go to D3. Finally, he plans to use go through D3 and block D4 with box 1. After computing the plan, Shaky begins to execute it. He moves to the first doorway by using the action go to D5.
The robots are still this slow, but the trick now is we speed up the video more to make them look faster, I guess. Is the only difference.
He looks through the doorway because he is uncertain about the contents of the next room. His view of the floor along his path shows no obstructions, so he moves into the next room by using the action go through D5. But just after this move, Charlie the Gremlin locks the next doorway with the box. Shaky doesn't know it yet, but the box is right in his planned path. Because the contents of this room are unknown, he checks the next leg of his journey with a television camera. The box is in Shaky's field of view. This is how it appears on a TV monitor. Shaky's vision programs analyze the picture and tell him that his path to the doorway is obstructed. He takes another TV picture of the obstructing object. Here we monitor on the cathode ray tube display the results of vision programs that enhance edges, identify the main regions of the scene, and determine the location of the box on the floor. Once located, the object that blocks his path can be entered in Shaky's model and given a name, Box 2. Now Shaky realizes that he cannot carry out the original version of his plan. His first recourse is to see if some other version of the old plan might work. Shaky remembers the form of a plan and can substitute other symbols into the same form to produce another version of the plan. In this case, Shaky was fortunate. The new version will solve his problem. Otherwise, he would have had to use Strips to make a brand new plan, possibly one that used the unblock action to clear the doorway. Here, though, Strips was not needed, so Shaky begins to execute the new version of the old plan. First, he turns and goes to another door.
All right, I'm going to stop it here. If you're in huge suspense, Shaky does in fact push the box into the blocking door. You can see the video on YouTube. It's about 20 minutes long, but it's really cool because it is really this case of quite complex plans and actions done again 50 years ago now, almost. And I think a lot of AI is still looking at similar problems. Now, we have moved quite a bit beyond that. It's not as if we are still doing this. But a lot of those same problems, this sort of problem of having a robot, for example, that will interact in an environment with normal users, that's still one of the key challenges facing AI. So next thing I want to mention, because it's also a very cool video, is some work done, and CMU can claim some of this, because Mark Raybert was here at CMU for a while before leaving for MIT. though I think this video is from MIT. And this bit, one thing he knows about Shaky, right, is that Shaky was moving. It was sort of impressive what he was doing in some sense intelligently, right, because he was replanning, looking at his environment, interacting. But the actual movement of Shaky was pretty shaky, to put it one way, right? That is, in fact, his name. And so it wasn't long after, though, that people started developing more the hardware of robots. And this work by Mark Rabert here at MIT is very famous for being kind of one of the most impressive demonstrations of what robots could do at the time. Mark has since gone on to found Boston Dynamics, which makes the Big Dog robot and the Pet Man robot, which you might have seen on YouTube at some point. These are more impressive than this, but given the time, I think this that is the date that these were created, I think these are very impressive as well. So this is a shorter video.
This was developed by Mark Rabert, who founded the MIT Leg Laboratory in the 1980s. To keep this simple, he started with one-legged robots.
So we built one-legged machine, the actual top robot, and we found that the control of these machines wasn't really too difficult.
The robot had sensors, which measured its motion, and had a computer brain, which used this information to reposition the leg between hops. The computer calculated where the legs should move to keep it balanced. Like all Rabert's dynamic robots, they had to keep moving to stay on their feet. His dynamic robots performed amazing feats.
Okay, so again, a couple demonstrations there about the kind of stuff that robots were doing, again, 25 years ago now. 35 years ago, sorry. Never keep track of what dates are what. All right, so I'm going to now talk about a few more things that are, again, kind of milestones. I don't have any more videos. These are more, a little bit more maybe just historical, but were very sort of pivotal in the development of AI as a field. So what happened in AI is, and I think this is, I don't think I'm too controversial saying this, is that during this initial enthusiasm, people had these wild expectations for how AI was going to develop. And the predominant thinking was that AI would work by essentially doing things like logic and manipulating symbols and doing reasoning in order to deduce conclusions from basic premises, essentially how you do deduction in mathematics. And this was sort of the thinking of the time, and despite this sort of the potential of all of this, it became known soon thereafter that these problems were actually NP-hard. So it was actually very hard to solve some of these problems, and the toy examples that people were showing kind of amazing performance on, things like Principia Mathematica, these were not going to scale to the extent that maybe we hoped for initially, right? And so around the 80s, a little bit different trend in AI came about, which is what became this topic of machine learning. But the idea here, and again, this dates back to the original perception algorithm, though it went out of fashion for a little while, is that the idea here was that instead of trying to encode kind of pure thought or logic as the means to an end, we might take cues instead from how our brains work. Not necessarily try to make things like our brains, but take some cues from that. And this led to an algorithm called a neural network. And we'll talk a little bit about neural networks in this course. Neural networks are making another comeback now. They've sort of made two comebacks, and they're right in the midst of another one. They're hugely popular right now. But what happened in the 80s was that the neural networks became popular, and particularly backpropagation as a way to train neural networks to make them learn from data became a popular algorithm, popularized by David Rummelhart and John Hopfield, among many others. But these sort of became kind of what people did in neural network machine learning. Later on, though, I think a lot of the initial work in AI focused largely on concrete knowledge, right? Things that were true always. And in the 80s, the influence of Judea Pearl and others, so again, these things do date back farther than that, started to become a lot more felt in AI. So in 88, Judea Pearl published a book called Probabilistic Reasoning in Intelligent Systems, and that really introduced, or at least laid a lot of the foundation for probability and Bayesian networks being at the forefront of AI. And we will talk about both probabilistic reasoning and Bayesian networks, because the reality is, a lot of the classical methods in AI, like Shakey's methods, they really worked with yes or no answers, right? They were logical systems, and in order to interact with the real world, the thought was, well, the real world is not quite that concrete. We need systems that will be able to act probabilistically. A couple other big milestones. In 97, Deep Blue defeated Garry Kasparov in chess. You'll notice those original pictures we had, I think, of Newell and Simon and of John McCarthy, they were both playing chess in those pictures. So chess was seen as this grand challenge for computers because it seemed to require intelligence, right? It's a game, the rules are well-defined, yet it seems to require intelligence to be able to actually play. And in 97, Deep Blue was for the first time able to beat a world champion at chess. And again, there is some debate over whether this really constitutes intelligence or not. What Deep Blue was doing was using a massive amount of computing, at least for the time a massive amount, to simulate a bunch of possible games and exactly the kind of methods we're going to learn about in this course, and would just have a lot more power than Garry Kasparov, right? There's no way he could simulate that many things at the same time. And so all his situational awareness and intelligence, in some sense, couldn't quite match up against that just brute, that the sort of the brute force solution there. So one thing, this is sort of important because it does sort of also typify a common theme in AI, being that something requires intelligence until it doesn't anymore, right? So for a long time, chess was the prime example of an intelligent system. Of course you couldn't play chess without intelligence. Once we solved it though, we realized, well, no, that's not quite intelligence anymore. And this is actually a common thread amongst a lot of AI, right? Because once we understand something, the inclination is to label it, well, that couldn't really be true intelligence. Intelligence is still this murky thing that we can't quite define. But I think we're getting to the point where it's hard to really say that with a straight face anymore, because these things are so good at what they do, and I'll show a few more examples later, current systems are so good at what they do, things that we use intelligence for, and they are so good at it that it's hard to say, well, the combination of all these things is unintelligent. I think that's a hard case to make these days. A few more things, again, bringing CMU and also Stanford to the forefront here. In 2005 and 2007, Stanford and then CMU won these two, first Stanford won, then CMU won these two contests run by DARPA to drive a car autonomously. In the first case, in 2005, they were driving a car through the desert, through like a desert trail. The second case, they were driving through a simulated city. It was actually on a military base, it wasn't a real city. Though, as we all probably know now, Google is in fact driving cars in the city and seems to be continuing this work very well. In fact, a lot of people from MIT and or from CMU and Stanford have since left to go work there. So this is again something where I think clearly driving a car requires intelligence, right? Everything that a car involves, so not just the control of the steering wheel, but figuring out your situation, what other cars are, where the pedestrians are, what's the right thing to do in different traffic situations. This clearly requires intelligence, you may say. But once you build a system, the temptation is to say, well, no, it's just a bunch of rules. And I think that the current thinking is that it's okay. What we're concerned about is accomplishing solving these hard problems. And we don't really care too much whether or not it's some sort of fuzzy intelligence or not, because these things, in some sense, just clearly are intelligence. They clearly are smart systems. Similarly, in 2011, this is the last one I'll say of the history at least, IBM's Watson beat the human opponents in Jeopardy. It made some sort of well-known mistakes too. You might have seen the mistakes it made. Like it asked what US city has some airport or something, and it said Toronto, and Toronto's not a US city. But it did beat them, and it waited very little on that because it wasn't very sure about that one. There's also, I think, some question of whether it just was able to buzz in faster. But it's still very impressive, right? It's able to just get the questions in plain text English, use a database to figure out what it's doing, all in an internal database, and then answer questions from that. And the last thing I'll say is that really AI is all around us now. What we call AI has taken a hold in things like face detection. If you bring up your camera, it will put a box around people's faces. It's running a machine learning algorithm to do that. This is an example of AI. Personal assistants, so Siri on your phone or Google Now, they're using a whole lot of speech recognition and then natural language processing to figure out what you're asking it and give you hopefully a good response. Again, with a Turing test, I don't think Siri would fool anyone into thinking that it was a human, but it still can be useful, right? And similarly this is supposed to be machine translation here, not, I changed my figure at the last point, but machine translation is Google Translate, translating some illegible English here to Chinese. Logistics planning, how do you schedule all these vehicles so that we can order a package and have it here the next day? That's actually a very hard problem, right? Just from a standpoint of many millions of packages being shipped every day, how do we do that? Now, all these things really do use techniques developed in the field of AI. Whether or not they are intelligent is debatable, but I think it's actually not the right question at all. The question is it useful, and does it require techniques that seem to address similar problems as does intelligence? And the answer for all these is obviously yes. Right? They require things that seem to need some form or another of intelligence. And that's all we're really going to worry about in this class. We're not going to worry too much about the philosophical issues of, well, are these boxes really intelligent or not? So, having said all that, now let me dive into the logistics of the course. Any questions about the history of AI? You can ask them on the Piazza board. In a class this big, I know it's sort of intimidating to ask questions sometimes. That's why we have the board. In fact, you're required to use Piazza, so you will have to, maybe not ask questions, you have to at least respond to questions. So, as you've probably seen from the syllabus, and we have a syllabus posted on the website, by the way. The website is here. It should be also on the class page, on the registrar's webpage. So you should be able to have already seen it. Bookmark it, because it's kind of a long thing, I know. But it'll have the syllabus, it'll have all the lectures, so we'll have slides from the lectures on it. And it will also have videos for the lectures, as much as we can. We're doing it ourselves. This is meant largely as just a resource for you to go back if you sort of want to re-look at something that was presented in the lecture. Videos are online. They're not intended as a substitute for lectures. In fact, you're required to come to lectures because you have to actually answer some in-class questions. But they are a resource there for you if you want it. So what we're going to cover in this class includes uninformed and informed search, numerical optimization, constraint satisfaction, integer programming, machine learning, classical planning, probabilistic planning and reinforcement learning, probabilistic reasoning, computer vision, robot motion planning, scheduling, natural language processing, and multi-agent systems. Okay, it's hard to even say, let alone do in one semester. What you will find is that there are entire courses on all these topics here at CMU. What this course is designed as is essentially an introduction to all these things for people who want to get that introduction without first spending a whole semester in each one of them. They're all very useful things, and you can invest, forget a semester, you can invest your entire career studying any of them. But if you are busy students, master's students, undergrads, graduate students, you might not want to do that, invest your career ahead of time, right? You might want to just get some sampling of everything. That's what this course is for. So this course is meant to be a sampling of all these different topics. That being said, it is going to be somewhat intensive. It is a graduate level course. There's an undergrad version of AI as well. And this course is going to be substantially harder than that one. It's just a graduate course. So despite the fact that these are going to cover a lot of things, in a lot of them, you will be required to actually implement things, to actually derive equations and expressions here, and program them. So this is not a learn about the ideas here. This is about implementing the ideas. In the next class, we'll talk much more about the precise things you're going to want to implement, and you know, languages you might need to know, stuff like that, and a more detailed schedule for the class. But all I'm going to say here is that this is the broad range of topics, and this is what you're going to be expected to come out knowing and having some experience with all of these things. All right, so now I didn't actually introduce myself ever, I realized, as I was giving this lecture, but I figured I shouldn't stop myself because I was, you know, on a roll, maybe. But I'm Zico, Zico Coulter. The other I'm one of the two instructors of this course. The other one is Zach Rubenstein, who is there. And the TA is Vittorio Pereira. That's how you pronounce your last name?
Yeah.
Okay, great. We will be your points of interaction to this course, obviously. I will be giving half the lectures, Zach will be giving half the lectures. Professor Rubenstein, either one is fine with me, actually. Does not matter. Yeah, be respectful. If you want to say Professor Zico, Professor Coulter, it doesn't matter to me. We will each have office hours. The office hours are on the webpage now. They weren't for a while, but they are now. Zach and I will have office hours directly after class. So today, after class, I will have my office hours. That is intentional. If office hours are separate, we find that oftentimes people don't ever bother coming to them. It's just an effort to make it in and come to an office. So my office hours are right after class today, and Zach's will be after class on Wednesdays. Mine are always after Mondays, his are always after Wednesdays. They're listed in our offices. My office is in Gates on the 7th floor, and his is in Neural Simon, but we will walk over there after class, so you're welcome to walk with us. Maybe we'll just hang out here, in fact, if there's too big of a crowd to fit in an office. In addition, Vittorio's holding office hours on Tuesdays and Thursdays, every Tuesday and Thursday from 1:30 to 3. So do use those resources. You are also welcome to use Piazza as a forum for interacting with us. We will try to answer questions within 24 hours of posting them to Piazza, hopefully faster if it's urgent, but we don't guarantee being faster. So also answer each other's questions because that can be useful as well. Is Piazza next? No, I think I have some. Sorry. A few more slides and then I'll actually describe what Piazza is, and we'll even run a quick little demo of it. Okay, so one question we've gotten a lot from this class is what background you need to actually take the course. There are no formal prerequisites. By that I mean just that we do not require you to have completed course X at CMU in order to sign up or get some exception. A lot of people here are master's or PhD students. They've probably taken similar courses elsewhere, so it would be silly to require a CMU undergrad programming course. That being said, this course requires programming. We're going to do assignments in Python. Chances are, if you are very good at programming but have not ever used Python before, you will be able to learn it for this course. It's meant to be a very easy language to learn. But at the same time, if you do not have any programming background, the chances of you being able to complete the assignments is very small. Just, it's life. This is a programming course. It's a computer science, advanced computer science graduate course. You have to program. Besides that, though, other background is mostly optional, I think. Maybe we'll find as we go through if that's really the case or not, but we're at least trying to make it be that other background is optional. You probably need some math background. We will do some proofs in this course. It's not just it's not math-free. There's plenty of math. But if you have a basic mathematical background, you've taken undergrad math, undergrad calculus, linear algebra, or probability, either or all of those, you'll probably will be okay. Again, I don't know for sure, but that's our hope. It's to not overload math component, though still keep some math there because you can't avoid math when you talk about optimization and machine learning and these kind of things. So if you know some data structure and algorithms, if you know linear algebra, if you know probability, that's great. It will be very helpful, but hopefully you will not be unable to do the course without it. Next, the textbook. There is a textbook for this course. Actually, has anyone checked to see if it's in the bookstore? Is it there? Has anyone bought it there? No one's even bought it there. That's great. So you shouldn't. You should probably just get it from Amazon anyway, right? It's probably cheaper. I don't know that for sure, but maybe it is. It's Artificial Intelligence, A Modern Approach. This is the standard textbook for AI courses. I think probably 50% of the courses on AI use this textbook. And we are having it be the official textbook because there is a lot of information that's covered there that we're going to cover in the course, and we want to give you that resource. That being said, we're not following this textbook at all, kind of chapter by chapter or anything like that. And there are some sections in this course that are going to be additional material that's not discussed in the textbook. So things like numerical optimization is not mentioned very much in this textbook, but yet optimization is kind of actually a fundamental principle behind a lot of current methods in AI. And so we are going to have a unit on numerical optimization separate from what's in the textbook. And other things are similar, though the textbook has information on a wide variety of things like we're going to cover, that we're going to cover, like computer vision and natural language processing, etc. And there we'll try to at least cover some of the same materials in the textbook so it will be a useful resource for you to read up on what we're talking about in class. If you have an older version, by the way, that's probably fine. Second edition is okay. I don't know, the first edition is pretty old, right? No. Second edition is fine. The first edition, probably time to upgrade. All right, and finally, the thing that I know is going to keep people, everyone wants to know, right, is how to, okay, so what's the grading going to be for the course? The grading, this is the official breakdown, for those that are curious, and we will stick to this. Problem sets, which we'll talk about in a second, are going to be worth 45% of the grade, midterm is 20%, course project is 25%, and class participation is 10%. I'll talk about what this means in a second, because no, you don't have to all ask questions and just make yourself heard in order to get that 10%. Problem sets. Okay, so problem sets. There are going to be four problem sets throughout the course, and these are really kind of one of the main components of the course, right? It is to test your knowledge of what we've taught you, and show us, both test it and extend it, I guess, right? Because we're actually going to program stuff and derive stuff on these assignments. They will each have written and programming assignments. The written portions, you'll turn in at the beginning of class every time. The programming parts will be turned in using AutoLab. AutoLab is a CMU automated grading system that will automate grading for the programming portions. Now, there's a few effects of this. It's very nice in some ways because you get to know beforehand whether or not, you get to know exactly what your grade is on the homework beforehand. The programming part of the homework beforehand, right? Because you can submit it as many times as you want before, see what score you get, if you do pass or fail, and you can see that. If you fail, you can submit again. But the downside is that it's not quite as helpful, you know, if you have no idea how to approach a problem and you just write some random stuff as you might, you know, to turn in when you're turning in code on paper, you will get no credit. Because what matters is what actually the computer says, how well your code does. So it will force you to actually solve the problems, and it can also mean sometimes that there might be small bugs that make everything look right, but you know, cause some issues. We will try very hard to resolve these, but these things do come up with automated grading. I think the benefit ultimately outweighs the downsides of it, though. Who's here has used AutoLab before, actually, by a show of hands? Okay, great. So there's some experience with it. So some people at least will be. And then you can maybe help the other folks that haven't before. Very important, and I'll mention this again one more time, but you can discuss problem sets in groups. It's encouraged, in fact, because one of the best ways of learning is to use this material, is to go over it in groups. That being said, it is very important that you write up and both written parts and code independently. Okay, so go to your group discussion. This is a very standard policy, I think, in a lot of classes these days. The policy is you can discuss them, go talk with your classmates about what the problems are about, try to figure them out together. Then when you're going to write them, take all those notes and put them aside and re-derive it all from scratch on your own for the written portion. It's very important, especially in programming. If you submit two things that are the same in programming, AutoLab will know exactly. Other times you might get by a few times because it's human, you know, error-prone humans that are looking at stuff, but that's still not allowed, and there's a good chance we will find it. So please write up your homeworks independently. I'm not going to talk about today the midterm of the course project. The course project we'll talk about more about next week. We'll have a separate document that describes that, that sort of says lies down the expectations there and what that's all about. But there will be no final for this course. The final is the course project is in lieu of the final. And that will involve a substantial near research level project that you will work on in groups. And the idea there is to delve very deeply into some particular area of AI, very likely, and in fact it's very encouraged if it is related to your separate research outside of this course. That's wonderful if you want to do that. Doesn't have to be also, by the way. You can pick some fun project that's just for this course. But we'll talk about that in a couple more classes. You should start thinking, that can be done in groups, and so you should start thinking already about what you might want to do for a final project and who you might want to work with if you want to do that. You can also do it by yourself, though, if you want. And on the final slot time, instead of the final, we'll have a poster presentation for the class projects. This is all pretty standard again. I think you've seen this in other courses before. There will be a midterm, though, and the midterm will be in class. It's on the schedule that's in the syllabus right now. So the midterm will be in class. It's designed to take about an hour. It will be designed to take an hour, but you will have the whole class period to do it. So hopefully people aren't too freaked out about that. Yeah. Oh, yeah, no question. Okay.
Regarding the problem set.
Yes.
I mean, are the programming assignments independent of the problem set?
No, they are all together in a bunch, and they're due the same time. So one of the problems on the problem set will be a programming assignment that you will just have to turn into auto lab by the same deadline as the when you turn in the paper portion.
Okay, so basically there are like four assignments with four deadlines.
Yes, exactly. And those deadlines should all be on the syllabus too. Okay, so class participation. This will get to Piazza in a second, but class participation is this 10% of your grade. And it's gonna be measured in two ways. So this is a fairly big class. We'll see how many people sort of drop out as time goes, but at least right now it's fairly big. There also, by the way, is a lot of people on the wait list still, so if you are, I mentioned this in the email, but if you are planning to drop out, please do that soon so people can get in officially and don't have to fret about getting off the wait list. I should mention that also here, I sent this in the email as well, we will make every effort possible to get everyone that wants to take this course into this course. So if you're on the wait list, even if you're number 30, try not to worry too much. We will try very hard to get you into the course officially. It might take a few weeks, but we will try. Do our very, very best to do this. And because of that, please continue to come to all the courses if you are on the waitlist as well. Because if you don't come to the courses, then you can't participate in the class, and so then you start lowering your grade there, and you don't want to come back, so it just builds up a vicious circle. So please come to the course. We will try to accommodate everyone, even if it means, you know, adding more chairs. I guess we can't do that legally, but we'll figure something out. So please come to the course. Class participation is going to be measured through, in fact, it's very important you come because this is going to be measured through participation in in-class polls. So we're going to use Piazza, at least in some of the lectures, we're going to use Piazza to ask everyone questions, and you have to respond to them. So we'll ask you a question, and you'll say, you know, A, B, multiple choice questions, and you just check which one you think is right. We'll do this in a second, actually. We'll go through it right now in a second. So you'll see what it will look like. And you have to answer. And in fact, half your grade here will just be the fact that you do answer. You could always select answer A, and you get 50% of class participation grade. It's just, we want you to be here, and we want you to participate. Think. And the reality is, no one's going to do that. You'll think about the answers to the question if you're asked it and have to respond to it. So you have to answer half of them. The rest, the other 50%, will be, do you get them right or not? You know, imagine that, actually caring about which answers you get. But if you don't get them all right, A, if you get, you know, enough right, it counts for 100% of that remaining 50%. And you can also boost this bit here by participating in the forums on Piazza, in particular answering or asking other questions. Answering in particular, we would really like that, if you could answer other people's questions. But the idea there with Piazza is that it's meant to be kind of a general forum. So we want you to be participating in it. We want you to be answering and thinking about other questions, seeing other questions, and using that as a resource to have this discussion amongst everyone in the class. So, Piazza now. Who here has used Piazza before? Okay, good, about half. Who here has signed up for Piazza for this course? Okay, so not everyone. So who here has a phone or a laptop with them and is not signed up? Okay, so if you are doing that, take a chance right now to sign up for Piazza. Maybe while I'm doing this next bit, because you won't be able to actually participate in it, so please sign up right now. You have to do two things. You have to sign up for Piazza, and you have to download either the Piazza app on your phone or bring a laptop to class. Is there anyone, by the way, if you cannot do either of those, come see us, that's fine. My guess is that everyone can probably do one of those two. Just chances are everyone that has a laptop or a smartphone. So we're going to use the app or the Piazza interface or an app in class, and we'll see how we do that in a second. So you have to bring one of those to class to answer the questions, or you will not be able to get that 50% for just answering questions because you will not be able to answer questions. Because of this, and this is very important, and this is sort of a sign that you are actually serious to us, for those who are not signed up by Piazza, by the beginning of next class next week, you will be dropped from the course. So just there's the threat right there, right? So please, please sign up. It is part of the course. It is part of your grade. You have to sign up to participate in the class. We'll see if we follow through on that. I think we probably will, because I think it'll be a small amount, but this is also to make room for those that are on the wait list, have signed up, in fact, for Piazza. Yeah?
Do we have to sign up with our CMU email
address? If you can sign up your Andrew with your Andrew ID, that's or with your Andrew email address, it's a little bit easier, because then we can correlate directly with the enrollment list. You don't have to, but if you, it doesn't seem to be any more effort, so do if you can. Unless there's a good reason not to, please, please do. Okay, so let's see what this looks like now. So this is a class poll. Here is the Piazza interface that you will see during class. So I'm going to click hide poll results because I don't want people seeing it until we're done. And now I'm going to publish the poll. So this poll just asks about your background. This one, I have to say, well, this will not, in all fairness, this one will not count towards your grade. But it's a good debugging chance right now to see if you can actually do this. So for those that have signed up before, see and verify that you, in fact, saw that I just did that. So I just published the poll. You should pop up either on your, if you have an app, it should sort of pop up as a new poll. If it's on the screen, you should be able to just type it in. Is anyone, people seeing it? People are seeing it? OK, good. All right, so answer the question. What's your background? There's 3 votes so far, so not very many. 10 votes. Oh, great. This is great, huh? Oh, down to 9 now. Did someone? Okay, great. I think only like 25 people registered when I, or 28 were registered when I came to class. So, is anyone still trying to vote and hasn't been able to yet?
Trying.
Okay. Piazza's being slow. Okay. Hopefully we'll be able to debug these things, and maybe we could like get on the CMU network if the 3G doesn't work here or something like that. But all right, anyone still trying? This one isn't too important, but anyone still trying and unable to vote? This is loading. On your phone or on your laptop? Okay, we'll go. We'll give it a few more minutes. I want to, and it's fine because normally these questions will be longer, and you'll have to actually work through them. So you think about them for a while, and hopefully then it's loading and just says it's fine. So, are you using the Piazza app or are you using the Piazza web page on your phone?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Well, hopefully the app will get faster. I'll give it a few more minutes, and then you can. If this still isn't working, you can try something else. All right, as I said, this one doesn't really matter, so we'll just do this now, and you can see what these kind of things look like. All right, I'll close the poll. Okay, so show poll results. All right, so here's the breakdown of students here. So a lot of computer science, computer science is a catch-all for people that are in computer science or other, you know, MLD maybe or HCI. But robotics, there were enough separate ones that I put a separate one for this. There's a lot of robotics here. Electrical engineering is also very big. There were some other engineers here, and there's one other. So who was that? Someone was here. It had to be someone here, right, in the room? Okay, it's all right. If you don't want to say, it's fine. But you have to be here somewhere, unless something's very strange. Okay, I mean, maybe like architecture or something, right? So all right, let's just do one more, see if it works. Let's see. This poll is a multiple choice poll now. So rather than just picking one, you can pick what areas interest you most. So I'm going to publish this poll now. and it says which areas. These are a bunch of things that interest you. You check them if they interest you. You do not check it if it does not interest you. This one will take a little bit longer because, I'm going to hide the results while we're voting. I'm going to feel really bad if, you know, the thing I was most excited about gets no votes and no one's excited about it. Typically, I'll give people about 5 minutes to answer these questions, depending on how complex they are. I mean, sometimes it's sort of a simple, did you get this or not? But they're quite valuable, I think, to get people to kind of interact more directly with material. And instead of just listening, you actually have to answer a question. And as I said, it will count towards your grade that you answer them. So if you're unable to get any, it's all just always loading, let me know, because that would be a problem. We'll try to figure out what's going on with your setup. This is more, so this is great. 29 to 28. I guess people are, you can re-vote though, I guess, this one. So if you check it accidentally, you can redo it. Maybe I'll put a timer up on these things so people know how much time they have. But I, for these ones, I'm not going to be very, very harsh. Okay, well, this time I will end it now, close the poll, and show the results. So sorry if you got cut off here. But okay, so machine learning, not surprisingly, is the most popular of all topics in AI. That was also borne out, by the way, in that word graph, right? So I like machine learning too. I'm also a machine learning guy. Search and planning are very popular here. Numerical optimization, I'm sad to see, is not that, as you were saying. It's not that. I have to convince you all that numerical optimization is really exciting now. So I hopefully will. It really lies at the foundation of machine learning. So you will really learn to love this. And then there are other things as well. So okay, great. This is actually very useful for us because it sort of gives a nice cool breakdown about what people actually like. Okay, so a couple more things. I only have 5 minutes left, so just let me go through them quickly. Late days. This is also a very common thing. You probably had this in the classes before. Four problem sets. There are also some milestones for the project due, but stuff comes up in classes. You know, you have some other deadline that's the same as this deadline. We don't want to penalize you too much for that, so you have 5 late days to use throughout the semester. This is the standard thing, where a late day means extending the deadline for 24 hours. And just 20, it's not like the midnight the next night. Class is due at the beginning of class, so extend it to 1:30 the next day, if you use one late day. You have 5 late days to use throughout the semester, and you can use no more than 3 on any given assignment. So you can't push the day back more than 3 days. And yes, weekends do count as days. They are not free weekends. If you are not able to turn in homework in class, you will turn it in Vittorio's office. If he is not there, slide it under the door. And regardless of whether he's there or not, write the time that you submit it on the paper. And that's bound, that time, by the way, is bound by the same honor code and academic integrity as everything else. Write the time that you submit it. So we know. Because frankly, when we look at them, we'll want to know when you're submitting it anyway, when we have all the things in a big pile. So please let us write on the thing when you're going to submit it. I think that covers all the things there. I don't want to miss anything because, again, the written homework should be due start of class, during class, program assignments, start of class, submitted through AutoLab.
The late days will not apply to the final project.
That's one thing. Late days do not apply to the write-up for the final project. That's in the syllabus. I should have probably put it here too. That's just because we need time to grade them. So you can use it for anything else, but don't use it for the final project. You will start getting points off the final project. I should say, again, also in the syllabus, if you violate this and go over your late days, you will start getting 20% off per day for each late day, for each day late you are. And we will be sticklers as much as we can about the exact times here, so don't try to push things. This is a slippery slope then, so please try to get it on the actual times.
Also, my office is 7:00, but I'm usually in the lab on the third floor.
Can they just put it in your office though, or?
Yes, but they won't find me.
Okay, so just slide it under the door then, you'll go get them. It's a little easier than putting it in a lab, I feel like, so.
Okay.
Yeah. All right, last thing, which is sort of a downer to end on. But I have one more nice slide after this. So we say this at the start of every semester. Every semester, I hope this will be the one where there's absolutely zero honor code violations. And for a class this size, somehow that hasn't happened yet. So I really hope this is the year. Please don't do it. For those that need it, CMU's academic integrity policy is here. It says exactly what you would think it would say. Don't violate it. And in particular, this is very important for this class, not because people actually sometimes it's very intentional. Sometimes people unintentionally cheat as well. And this happens most often with this requirement that you have to write things up separately. So just remember that. You can talk about homeworks in groups, talk about programming assignments in groups, write them up independently. That's probably the number one cause for honor code violations in most classes. It's just people not doing that. You see two identical homeworks that were handed in. So please, please don't do that. If you consult outside material as well, and you are allowed to, for the most part, unless we say not to, unless we specifically say for this problem you cannot consult anything else, you have to list what it is. Okay, so this has become a pretty standard set of requirements at this point. Hopefully you've seen something similar before in a similar class, in another class, but please, it's much easier for us and much easier for you if everything just goes smoothly in this respect. So that, ending on that kind of down note there, I'm going to add a couple parting thoughts about AI in general. These are hard problems, the problems we're tackling in this course. All right, and next lecture we'll talk about in a lot more detail sort of precisely how we'll structure this course and how we'll cover the different topics. But these are hard topics, kind of the hardest topics. And I think this is really exemplified by the fact that in the early days of computers, there was wild optimism that does not even begin to cover how far we've made it. Right? So there's this very famous Popular Mechanics, which is kind of misquoted, honestly, this quote here. Famous quote from Popular Mechanics saying in 49, saying that in the future, computers may only have 1,000 vacutums and may weigh only 1.5 tons. Okay, so this is appears in some quote every other day, but very famous quote here. And that was already being kind of optimistic at the time. And contrast that with Herbert Simon, who was a very smart guy, right? In 65 said, machines will be capable within 20 years of doing any work a man can do. Right? So we all laugh about how these predictions were wildly inaccurate on the downside. But the predictions in AI are kind of going the other way. I think this speaks to not the fact that these people weren't as smart as these ones. It's just that these are hard problems. And so you will be solving the hardest problems that there are during this course. And hopefully that's exciting to everyone. So hope to see you next lecture.
I have a question about the project.
Yeah. Let me actually wait till he turns off the recording so you don't get your question heard by everyone. But you could do that too.